the Yellow Jackets and the Wolfpack. Georgia Tech winners their last time out, beating Virginia Tech on Sunday by an 87-81 score. That puts the Jackets at 14-9 on the year, 3-7 in the Atlantic Coast Conference. While NC State comes in 17th in the national polls. They won four of their last five, had a big victory last Thursday night on the road, beating Louisville 72-70 in overtime. This is their third straight road game. But Fallon, they have been a very good team on the road. This is an interesting showdown tonight between the Yellow Jackets and the Wolfpack as both try to make their move up the standings of the ACC.
It's very interesting. Right now, NC State's in a good position in the ACC Conference. They played extremely well, probably have overachieved more than what people have expected this season. But they're playing for a big reason tonight. It's for Kay Yao, and they probably have a chip on their shoulder and will be playing with a lot of emotion. Where you have Georgia Tech, who they're coming off a big win, a much-needed win against Virginia Tech team, a good Virginia Tech team this past Sunday. So they're looking to extend their win streak and build off of that win and hopefully move forward to progress and move up in the ACC Conference.
Pink will be the color of the night this evening here in Atlanta. The Yellow Jackets will forego their usual white and gold and wear a pink version of their home uniform. NC State, they're the school that helped originate wearing the pink uniforms and the Play for K initiative. They'll come out in a black version of their uniform, but nicely trimmed in pink numerals and lettering. And again, to honor their legendary coach, Kay Yao.
Yeah, the uniforms are awesome. This is always a great time of the season, great event. So I know both teams will be very pumped and they're ready to play. They're playing for a huge cause and also for a big win.
Katarina Vucevic jumps center for the Yellow Jackets. She's a 6'3" tall senior from Serbia. She'll go up against Chelsea Nelson, who's a 6'2" tall junior from Antioch, Tennessee. The opening tip is controlled by the Yellow Jackets. So again, wearing pink here at home. Imani Tilford is at the controls of the offense. Tilford is the junior point guard. Zaire O'Neal, the ACC Player of the Week, fed that pass down low into a cutting Katarina Vucevic.
And that was a great way to start the game. O'Neal at the high post and saw Vucevic cut into the basket. Great pass, great finish by Vucevic.
Off the back door cut, Georgia Tech scores first. It's 2-0 in favor of the Yellow Jackets. Maya Spencer is a local product to Atlanta, a 5'8" tall senior from Decatur. She has the ball out top of the Wolfpack and looks to drive in down low for a runner against Zaire O'Neal that was no good. Tilford comes away with a rebound, and ever quick, Tilford will stutter step into the lane, trying to go all the way down for a banker that was too hard off glass only. Here's Dominique Wilson coming back the other way for the Wolfpack. Out top, Ashley Williams gets a three-point look. It's off the back iron and no good, and on the battle for the rebound, Ed Sidlaski has the first whistle of the evening. The foul call is going to go against Georgia Tech's Francesca Pond.
Yeah, that was just great hustle right there. That was an inadvertent knockdown, I think, of strength for NC State. She fell. It was just great hustle by both teams. But right now, NC State's crashing the boards extremely hard. Georgia Tech, they're going to have to box out because that's something NC State, they try to get second chance points and second chance opportunities.
Spencer will inbound. She's joined on the floor by Ashley Williams. As we mentioned, Chelsea Nelson, the post player, Dominique Wilson, and Jennifer Maturin completing the Wolfpack lineup. This is Wilson working out court, trying to work a two-man game with Nelson. Wilson chose to shoot it herself, and the rebound winds up going out of bounds. It'll be Georgia Tech ball.
That was another great possession. Defensive stop for Georgia Tech right there. They need to look to capitalize and try and score something within their offense.
Monty Tilford continues to run the Yellow Jackets lineup. She's out there with Francesca Pond, Alo Ada Faroka, Katarina Vucevic, and here is Zaire O'Neal swinging it back to Tilford, stepping up on the baseline to try a jumper from the left side. That's good. Monty Tilford's really picked up her scoring the last few games. Three straight contests, she's been in double figures, and the Yellow Jackets have an early 4-0 lead.
Well, she's just been extremely aggressive, and that's what the Jackets have needed in her point guard play. She's been playing extremely well.
Spencer missed a tough banker off of her drive down low. Here's Vucevic feeling confident these days from three-point range and missing, but Zaire O'Neal on the rebound puts it back up and no good and gets fouled in the process.
Well, even though Vucevic missed that three-point shot, it's good to see her confidence going on the offensive end. That's something that she's been lacking a bit this season, but in the last few games, she's been playing extremely well and giving the Jackets a great three-point asset from the outside.
The foul was on Dominique Wilson of NC State, her first. Zaire O'Neal goes to the free throw line and feeling some confidence off of what she did on Sunday. Yellow Jackets were huge in the fourth quarter of Sunday's game over Virginia Tech. at the free throw line, and O'Neal makes her first. She's now made seven in a row at the free throw line.
And that's good. That's something the Jackets need to do to capitalize if they're going to continue to win games. They have to hit shots from the free throw line.
O'Neal is 2 for 2, and the Yellow Jackets, although 10th worst in the nation in shooting free throws at just a tick under 60%, these days they look much better than that, and they lead NC State 6-0. Wilson tried to drive to the baseline. Pulani Spurlock will have a foul call against the Yellow Jackets, Imani Silford, as she picks up her first.
Well, the guards from NC State are very aggressive. You saw Wilson just penetrate right there. Tilford tried to cut her off on the baseline, but unfortunately gets called for the foul.
Spencer inbound to the corner, finding Jennifer Maturin, getting her first touch of the ball. Now outcourt Dominique Wilson has the handle. Watched out top in an interesting matchup as she works against Zaire O'Neal. Williams now with the shot clock still at 15 for the Wolfpack. Spencer will drive down inside, getting in around Ada Faroka for a scoop with the left hand this good, and she got fouled. Quite a way for NC State to finally get on the board, and Maya Spencer will go to the line, try to complete a three-point play.
Well, that was a great penetration right there by Spencer. She took it hard, took it deep to the basket. You know, NC State, they have great penetrating guards. We said, you know, they have great starting leadership, senior leadership in their starting lineup. So they were trying to get on the board in this quarter, and she was able to make it happen.
The foul is on Yellow Jackets' Alo Ada Faroka. She draws her first personal. Already three team fouls against Georgia Tech. Maya Spencer makes the free throw, and the Wolfpack have a lot of tremendous free throw shooters. Spencer, at 80% for the year, completes the three-point play.
And that's something the Jackets cannot get caught up in this evening. They can't commit a lot of fouls and put NC State on the free throw line because, like you said, they're a great free throw shooting team.
Antonio Parisone now on the floor as the Yellow Jackets get a little smaller in the process. Alo Ada Faroka leaving the game. Inside, Zaire O'Neal wheeling in effectively and laying it home with the left hand for her first field goal.
And she's just continuing to play extremely well. She's had a great couple of games, ACC Player of the Week, and she's just leaving it all on the floor.
Jennifer Maturin missed the three out of the right corner. Francesca Pond seemingly had position for the rebound. She's going to wind up getting called on the foul, and that is her second already.
And that's something you don't want to see. You know, Pond, she's been trying to get a rhythm, and her picking up two quick fouls is not a good sign for her this evening. She's going to have to go to the bench.
Already four team fouls against the Yellow Jackets. Shannon Scott, the freshman, is now on the floor for the Yellow Jackets. Their second sub off the bench. In turn, Nelson kicks it out to the right corner for Maturin to try a three that's no good. Rebound to the floor with Parisone and Nelson both after it. It's Nelson who knocked it away over the baseline. It'll be Georgia Tech possession.
And that was good hustle by Nelson and Parisone. Nelson, she hustles. She's crashing the boards hard. The Jackets, they're going to have to put a body on her because at some point she's going to get an offensive rebound.
An 8-3 lead for Georgia Tech. Tilford works stop and go around the right side of the floor. Feed it in the lane for O'Neal. A tough catch. Nice pass inside for Tilford, who went in to get the feed for the layup, and she got fouled.
You know, I think Zaire O'Neal, she doesn't get enough credit for how great of a passer she is when she's in post position or down low on the block. That was another great look. She saw Tilford cutting. Unfortunately, Tilford couldn't finish the play with the layup, but she did draw the foul.
Ashley Williams picked up her first personal. What has really showcased O'Neal's passing is the fact that the Georgia Tech guards have become more of offensive threats of late. So she's looking for them, and it's helping everyone all around.
And that's good. When you have a great post presence and a post player that can pass the basketball, guards love that because you can cut, find different positions, and look for the basketball because you know your post player is going to give it to you.
Imani Tilford goes 2 for 2 at the free throw line. She's going great from the line lately. Yellow Jackets lead at 10-3 off the miss off the right wing by Dominique Wilson. Yellow Jackets come away with a rebound. Tilford finding Vucevic, faking inside for the layup that's good.
That was great hustle by Vucevic. You get down the floor. She was the first one back. Great look by Tilford.
A surprise here in Atlanta as NC State has to take an early time out. Their head coach, Wes Moore, has seen enough. With 6:27 to go in our first half, Georgia Tech is off and running. The Yellow Jackets lead the Wolfpack by a 12-3 score. Well, coming out of that NC State timeout, Wolfpack will stay with the same group that began the game. Big thing about that timeout, from Wes Moore's perspective, get his starters going. They'll work it to Dominique Wilson on the right wing. a double screen offered to her out top. Right side now, Maya Spencer. Mathurine in the high post, in the lane. They get Chelsea Nelson a touch. She misses the one-hander inside, but Spencer's there to grab the rebound. Wilson had a notion about the three, drives inside, again trying to find Nelson, but off her hand and out of bounds, and the Wolfpack turn it over. It's their first turnover of the evening.
Yeah, Nelson is working extremely hard down low, but for some aspects, she's being doubled. It's a tech guard ducking in on her, so it's making it hard for NC State to pass the ball down low, but she's working extremely hard. Unfortunately, she hasn't been able to score yet.
Monty Tilford splits the defense, got inside for the scoop layup. The rebound is tied up by the duo of O'Neal and Mathurine. The possession arrow favors NC State.
That was great hustle again by both teams right there. They're getting on the floor, diving for it, and trying to get a jump ball or save the possession.
5:43 to go in this first quarter. Georgia Tech playing defense, leading NC State 12-3. Maya Spencer runs the offense. Imani Tilford watching her out top, and again, they offer a choice of screens. Mathurine got handcuffed by that pass. Tilford, aggressive, tried to take it away and get off running, but could not control it. Mathurine that time was not especially aggressive in going after that loose ball, and she, perhaps not coincidentally, will check out. She's going to be replaced by Dee Dee Rogers. We know all about Dee Dee Rogers' sister, Rodrika Rogers. Had a great 4 years here at Georgia Tech. The younger sister is a 6'1 sophomore from Charlotte, and Rodrika and Dee Dee's dad, of course, former Wake Forest great, and I mean great, Rodney Rogers. Forecourt Tilford working the high post to O'Neal, turning over the defender to try a jumper that's no good. The rebound to Dee Dee Rogers. Still a 12-3 lead for Georgia Tech. Spencer gets it down to the baseline. They're working to Nelson yet again, posting up on O'Neal. This time she gets the banker to go.
And that was a great move right there by Nelson. She got great post position against O'Neal, had her on the block one-on-one, and just took a couple of dribbles, made a spin, and was able to score.
Wolfpack with their second bucket of the evening so far. They trail Georgia Tech 12-5. Freshman Shannon Scott, also from Charlotte, in the game. Bouncing it to Tilford, faking down inside between two taller defenders. It would not get up to the iron. Tilford trying to knock it loose, keep it alive for a teammate, but it winds up going out of bounds. It'll be NC State ball.
Yeah, on that possession right there, that's the shot that Scott probably should have taken rather than passing it to Tilford. It was a great cut, but Tilford was a little small down there amongst the trees. When Scott has an opportunity to score like that in the lane, she has to take it.
Spencer is peeking back over her shoulder for instructions from head coach Wes Moore, who's in his third season with the Wolfpack after a great run at UT Chattanooga. At the foul line, here is Wilson open for a jumper that's good.
That was a good shot. It was good passing by NC State to get the open shot for Wilson right there at the free throw line. The Jackets have to recover a little bit faster.
It's a homecoming for four NC State players to the Atlanta area, and Wilson is among them. She comes out of Powder Springs up in Cobb County, a McEachern High School product. Makes it 12-7. Tilford gets a pass out on the left side to try a three that's no good. Rebound pulled out of there by Maya Spencer for the Wolfpack. Up the left wing, Wilson will stop and pop a jumper over Vucevic that rimmed out. Rebound, Nelson getting busy inside. Her follow is up and good, and she got fouled. Kelsey Nelson will go to the line trying to complete a three-point play.
Yeah, and that's something that O'Neal cannot do. Nelson's been hustling all game long. She's been crashing the boards extremely hard, and they know she's looking to score when she gets the ball down low. O'Neal should have stayed on her feet, just kept her arms up, and she picks up a tough foul right there and has to go to the bench.
Foul on O'Neal is her first. Nelson, a 70% free throw shooter who converts. Nelson, of course, is NC State's leading scorer. One of the reasons they want to get her involved, but there's that bonus when she's working against O'Neal. If they can get O'Neal in foul trouble, it's a completely different Georgia Tech team when she's on the bench.
It is, and that's something O'Neal's been not doing the last two or three games, getting in foul trouble and staying in the ball game. She's important.
Here's Kaylin Pugh for the Yellow Jackets, now on the right side to Imani Tilford. She'll retreat and reset the offense in the half court. At the left elbow, Pugh gets it, trying to drive down inside, doing her thing, going up strong for a banker, no good. Rebound to Alo Ada Faroka, who scoops it up with the left hand to good.
And that's something NC State they don't have. They don't have post players that are hustling or have big bodies down low in order to crash the boards that hard and get offensive boards. A great job by Ada Faroka.
Breaks up a little bit of an NC State run. Back at you from the other end, though, Ashley Williams with a three. And it's a one-point game.
Yeah, that was a nice shot by Ashley Williams. She took it in rhythm and was able to knock that three down, and now it is a one-point game.
Georgia Tech once led 12-3. Now it's 14-3 with 2:38 to go in the first quarter. Tilford to Antonio Parison, the sharp-shooting three-point specialist from Italy converts.
Parison is just leaving. Just started where she left off last game. Great steal by Pugh.
Pugh at midcourt will go off to the races for a layup that's good.
And that's what gets her going. She is a slasher, scorer, driver to the basket. She likes to get layups.
NC State back quickly the other way. Westmore was waving his arms, telling Maya Spencer to move it, and she found Dee Dee Rogers in there for the layup.
And that's what the Jackets cannot do. They have to get back on transition defense when they get steals like that. They can't let NC State score so easily.
Off the exchange of buckets, it's 19-15. Georgia Tech leading NC State with under 2 minutes to go in the first quarter. Parison swings it to Pugh on the left side. Pugh is very good on the dribble penetration. To Parison, trying to go baseline herself for a floater that is no good. The rebound to Williams. Forecourt quickly, it's Wilson. As NC State starts to step the tempo in this game, Wilson gets all the way down inside for an off-balance runner that was no good. Pugh back the other way for Georgia Tech. The Wolfpack have three, now four players back. It's going to be a blocking call, however. They tried to stop Pugh on her penetration, but Maya Spencer picks up her first.
Yeah, and that was a great drive by Pugh. She was driving to the basket, but saw the corner of her eye. She saw Vucevic in the corner wide open and was trying to make the pass, but was able to draw the foul.
For NC State, it's their third team foul. Officials here have to decide in the act or not. It's going to be a baseline inbounds.
I didn't think
she was on
act.
The drive, thinking about the pass perhaps, as you noted.
Yeah.
And so no free throws here. You get around to this time of the quarter, officials are almost assuming as well that a team would be in the bonus at this point, but Yellow Jackets were not. Down low, Ada Faroka with her back to the basket against Nelson. Rolls inside for a shot that went in and out. Nelson clears the rebound.
Yeah, that was a good shot by Ada Faroka. Unfortunately, it didn't go down.
A four-point Georgia Tech lead. Dee Dee Rogers drives in the lane. Out to the wing for Spencer. She measures Tilford. Tilford's trying to make her go to her left. She'll work to her left behind the Nelson screen. Out to Williams on the wing. Down low to Nelson, who got a mismatch on Imani Tilford. Tilford left to foul, and that's a problem for Georgia Tech. It's her second.
Yeah, and you cannot have Tilford in foul trouble. That's one person they need on the floor. She's been great these last few games and has been a great leader and a great ball handler for the Georgia Tech Lady Jackets as a starting point guard.
At the free throw line, you'll find Chelsea Nelson for the second time. She makes the first of two. We'll get the sub. Tilford obviously will sit down with the two fouls. So Georgia Tech has both Tilford and O'Neal, perhaps their two most important players of late, on the bench. Into the ballgame for the first time. It's grad student Shay Sweeney, at 5'2" tall. She hails from Toledo, Ohio. Off the miss of the free throw, NC State wound up grabbing the rebound as Georgia Tech was just slow in getting after the ball. Chelsea Nelson takes advantage.
Yeah, that's just miscommunication right there. You had Sweeney and you had Vucevic both looking at the basketball, and then neither one of them grabs it. And NC State just comes back in for the easy steal, and they're able to draw the foul, get back to the free throw line.
Nelson missed the layup. It goes to the line for the first of two. It's good. That foul, by the way, was on Alo Ada Faroka. So now three Georgia Tech starters have two fouls here in the first 9 minutes of the game.
And that's unfortunate because that's something that could have been prevented if either Vucevic or Sweeney gets that rebound.
Nelson made the first but missed the second. Pugh wrestles the rebound away. Yellow Jackets come forecourt. Here's Sweeney driving around the Chelsea Guimarães screen for a runner in the lane that's good.
And that's good for Sweeney to see her going. We haven't seen her really play much in the last few games, but to get her going offensively, that's going to be huge with Tilford on the bench for the Jackets.
Sweeney averaged better than 600 points a year in three seasons at Eastern Michigan. She's now within 78 points for her collegiate career of reaching the 2,000-point mark. Georgia Tech leads NC State 21-17. Had 23 seconds to go in the quarter. Foul line jumper is no good right there by Dominique Wilson. The rebound goes out of bounds. It'll be Georgia Tech ball with the shot clock turned off and 19.9 seconds remaining in the quarter. Nelson's going to sit in anticipation of the quarter break.
Yeah, that's one player NC State definitely does not want to get in foul trouble. They want to give her some rest because she's been playing hard, extremely hard on the low block for NC State.
Akilah Mays, a 6'5" tall junior from Greensboro, replaces her. Jackets will watch the clock run as Sweeney goes to work with 7 seconds. She'll pull up the foul line for a jumper that's no good. Rebound, battled for. Kayla Ely had hands on it for the Wolfpack and wound up getting fouled. And with 3.6 seconds to go, Georgia Tech over the limit. It means free throws are coming up.
And I know that's something Michelle Joseph did not want to see this late in the quarter, but, you know, Sweeney, she took a shot. She was trying to hustle for her own rebound, and unfortunately she bumps into the NC State player, and now NC State's going to the free throw line.
First foul on Shea Sweeney. That's 8 fouls overall against Georgia Tech here in the first quarter to just 3 for the Wolfpack. Free throw no good for Kayla Ely, who has been struggling some in that department. She started the season by making 8 of her first 9 free throws, 11 of 24 since that time. Takes 1 out of 2 on this trip. Jackets have to hurry now. 3.6 seconds to go. They'll put it in Sweeney's hands. She'll speed dribble forecourt and let it fly from 40 feet away. It was just short as the buzzer sounds to end the first quarter of play here in Atlanta. Georgia Tech got off to a great start. NC State comes back. It's a 3-point game at the quarter.
Yeah, that was a good first quarter. Georgia Tech started on a good run and had like a 12-3 lead, forcing NC State to call a timeout, but NC State just gathered themselves and was able to get back in this ballgame.
Second quarter action coming up from here at McCamish Pavilion in Atlanta. Richard Muster and Fallon Stokes back here at McCamish Pavilion in Atlanta as Georgia Tech leads NC State 21-18 for the Yellow Jackets in the first quarter. 8 out of 18 field goal shooting, 1 out of 3 from 3-point range, and 4 for 4 from the free throw line. 3 different Yellow Jackets players with 4 points each. Katarina Vucevic, Zaire O'Neal, and Imani Topher. They were the ringleaders early as Georgia Tech jumped out to a 12-3 lead, but then foul trouble slowed Georgia Tech. Zaire O'Neal picked up a foul, went to the bench. Halo Ada Faroka, Francesca Pond, Imani Topher, each with 2 fouls as well. NC State capitalizing to a degree. Their field goal shooting a little below par. They were 6 out of 17, just 35% from a team that shoots better than 42% for the season. 1 of 5 from 3-point range. They made frequent trips to the line, though, going 5 out of 8. NC State an edge in the rebounding, 11 to 10. The Wolfpack committed only 3 turnovers in the first half. The Yellow Jackets did even better. A goose egg, and that's a good goose egg in the turnover category.
Oh, that's a great sign early for the Jackets, you know, limiting turnovers, and then at the same time, shooting well from the free throw line. They were 4 for 4 when they got opportunities to go, but the foul trouble is something that's been plaguing the Jackets all year. They have 4 starters with 2 fouls, and that's not going to work. You know, the Jackets are going to have to find a way to play better control defense and not foul so easily.
Zaire O'Neal will return to the lineup here to begin the second quarter. Antonio Parison runs the point with Imani Tilford on the bench with those 2 fouls. They look for O'Neal immediately. Parison trying to find her on the lob inside, but Wolfpack interior defense was good against a taller player that time and knocking it away.
And Parison saying, my bad, hitting her chest, knowing that she probably should not have made that pass, but fortunately the Jackets regained the possession.
O'Neal inbounds to Parison. That duo goes right back to work. O'Neal, though, had the ball knocked out of her hands by Akilah Mays, and the Yellow Jackets do commit their first turnover. NC State could tie this game on a 3. Here is Maya Spencer trying to drive the lane. They'll rotate it to the right corner. There's a 3 ball from Dee Dee Rogers that's no good. The rebound to Kaylin Pugh, and she'll take it upon herself to drive it forecourt. Getting into the lane, working it to O'Neal. Wraparound pass for Vucevic in the paint. Her little jumper is short. Mays with the rebound. NC State will come back the other way on the control break, where Spencer will slow things down on the right wing to Rogers in the right corner. They're looking to the low post, see if they get Mays involved, as Chelsea Nelson does begin the second quarter on the bench. Here's Spencer getting down inside, missing the runner, hitting the bottom of the iron. The rebound to Katarina Vucevic.
I mean, it's been a foot race the last few possessions. The Jackets need to settle down a bit and see if they can score something within their offense, because the last couple of trips they've had good looks but just couldn't convert.
Freshman Shannon Scott will hand it off on the left side to Pugh. Down on the left block, it's Vucevic. Whip it out to O'Neal, trying to get down the left of the lane with the step as she went between defenders and got fouled.
And that's a great take right there. That's something that Zaire does extremely well, taking and driving that basketball to the basket. She's a very agile player as a post player for the Jackets. So she's able to draw fouls and get to the free throw line. And let's see if she can connect for these two. Or it was on the floor.
That was on Akilah Mays. Mays does run in some foul difficulty. Vucevic will inbound, out top to O'Neal on a look-away drive into the lane for the runner that was no good. The foul call, however, Lenny Spurlock and Kathleen Lynch discussing things. And it's going to go against NC State for a moment. The Tech fans got very quiet thinking that the signs were indicating it was going to be an offensive foul call against O'Neal, which could have been her second. And now you've got the three officials all meeting here.
And you see Zaire O'Neal, she was praying to heavens above that that foul was not called on her. She was very concerned. She did not want to pick up another one.
This is going to lead to a trip to the monitor. Ed Sidlowski and Kathleen Lynch will go over there and take a look at things. Again, Kulani Spurlock is the third member of our officiating crew. As we've reached here into the month of February, all three of these officials, a veteran crew, have worked more than 50 games already on the season. And let's look at this ourselves. One thing they might be looking at are feet relative to the circle.
Because I didn't think you could look at the monitor to see about fouls, but I guess if that's a concern, to see if the feet were outside of the circle, and you probably would need to look
at the
monitor.
And when you have a difference of opinion among officials as well, it may be one offensive, one defense, and a third who says, I don't have an opinion. The foul is on Jennifer Maturin. It's her first. And so it puts Zaire O'Neal at the free throw line, and this works out exceptionally well for Georgia Tech. Instead of oh no, it becomes oh yes as O'Neal gets ready to shoot two. First free throw is good.
And she's still looking great from the free throw line. I think she's perfect this evening thus far. And this is big. She's driving the ball to the basket. She's still being very active on the offensive end, and that's something the Jackets need from her.
She now has a double-digit free throw shooting streak. 10 in a row, dating back to Sunday's win over Virginia Tech. It includes 4-for-4 tonight, and it's 23-18 on the drive. Maya Spencer got fouled well out court. Foul's going to go against Shannon Scott, so the freshman picks up her first.
That's a tough call, but that's something that's going to slow this game down. The Jackets have to stop fouling and just play solid defense by moving their feet.
Mays gets it in the post to try a jumper that was over the iron, hitting glass only and no good. Pugh with the rebound, races out the other way, had it knocked away from behind. It'll go out of bounds to the baseline and remain Georgia Tech ball.
She's fast. She's like a head full of steam. When she's going down the court, you know exactly where she's going, straight to the basket.
There's 26 on the shot clock as Georgia Tech will inbound from the baseline. Parasol looking to put it in play, finds O'Neal on the left block, spinning on Mays. She's called on a travel as she faked one way, tried to go the other.
Yeah, it was. She switched pivot feet when she was trying to make the spin back, and unfortunately gets called for the travel.
Resetting the Georgia Tech lineup, by the way, with the foul difficulty they've had. You have Parasol and Pugh as the guards. Scott, Vucevic, and O'Neal up front on defense right now. For NC State, Dominique Wilson gets it on the left wing, working behind the double screen from Mays and Maturin. Williams gets it on the right wing. Pugh will get out on her three-point shooting threat that Ashley Williams is. Rotate it to Wilson on the left side. You got to get after her from three-point range. She just knocked that one in easily.
She did, and you have to get your hands up and get out there on those three-point shooters. Wilson is a three-point shooter, and I'm sure that was on the scouting report for the Jackets.
The Wolfpack have two threes on the game. They're within two. O'Neal bumping inside against Mays. Shot no good. O'Neal, her own rebound, puts it up again and gets it to go.
O'Neal is just being dominant right now. She misses the first layup. Still goes after it, gets her own rebound, and is able to put it back up.
In back-to-back games, O'Neal had 24 points against Virginia, went one better with 25 on Sunday against Virginia Tech, and now 8 points already in this game. Dominique Wilson tries to go baseline on the left side, winds up stepping out of bounds on good defense by the Yellow Jackets.
Yeah, it was great defense, and they've been doing that extremely well when players have been trying to penetrate baseline. They've been cutting that baseline off and getting some turnovers because the players have been stepping out of bounds.
Four NC State turnovers. We have 7:19 to go in the second quarter. Georgia Tech trying to add to a 25-21 lead. Pugh turns and tries a jumper from 16. That's good.
That's something we don't see too often. Just a pull-up. She was looking to penetrate, but decided to pull up for the J. Great job by Pugh.
That'll keep the defense honest. She's got 4 points. Wilson drives to the right elbow and misses the jumper. Rebound to the athletic freshman, Shannon Scott. Forecourt, Georgia Tech trying to add to a 6-point lead now here in the second quarter as Parasol stops on the right wing. Into O'Neal, working against Mays, faking one way, popping the jumper the other.
That was some old school Akeem Olajuwon right there. It was a great move by O'Neal. Great little shimmy shake, and she was able to hit the floater in the lane.
Zaire O'Neal has 10. Wilson misses a three-pointer from the right wing, but NC State grabs the rebound with Kaylin Ely. Here's Maturina trying to go left baseline. Stepped on the end line as she could not get around Katarina Vucevic cleanly.
And that's another great job. We've been saying it. It's something that they definitely work on at practice. Michelle Joseph, she emphasizes the fact when players are going to the baseline, cut the baseline off. Send them out of bounds.
Georgia Tech has an 8-point lead. It's 29-21 with 6:20 remaining in the second quarter. Maya Spencer, by the way, to the scorers table, will get in on the next dead ball for NC State. Meanwhile, for Georgia Tech, Kaylin Pugh has it on the left wing. Down in the post, there's activity. Zaire O'Neal is trying to get position for the entry pass, and she's going to be called on her second personal foul. So now there is the oh-no moment for Georgia Tech. You've got Tilford, Pond, Ada Faroka, and O'Neal now with two fouls each.
Yeah, and it was Nelson and Zaire, they were fighting on the post, on the block. That's something that's going to be happening all evening. That time, Nelson got the better of the call.
Maya Spencer back out there for NC State, working behind the Nelson screen. Swings it out to the left corner for Williams to try a three that was halfway down and back out. Maturin, after the rebound, is going to be called on a push-off. So the senior from Montreal picks up her second foul.
Yeah, Maturin was not happy about that one, and she was close to getting a technical foul call by bouncing that ball. She caught it in time, but that's another great defensive stance right there by the Jackets, so great boxing out.
Parison continues to run the point with Imani Tilford on the bench with the foul trouble. Parison is very steady, player who takes care of the basketball very well. Brings it around the left side, handing it to Shannon Scott, the shot clock down to 10. Scott will bring it out top. Shot clock's down to 7. Let's see what Scott does with it. Bounce it high post to Chelsea Guimarães with her back to the basket. Hand it off to Parison. Shot clock down to 1. Parison trying to desperately improvise, has nowhere to go with it. Throws it up and out of bounds. NC State takes over on the shot clock violation.
And that's something Parison, when she's running the point, she has to be aware that she knew that shot clock was going down. She had to pull that shot. She couldn't look for Guimarães or someone else down low. It was her job to take that shot.
You're a point guard missing your primary offensive weapons like Zaire O'Neal or Imani Tilford. Down inside, Nelson misses a left-hander. Rebound taken away by Parison for the Yellow Jackets. Chase Sweeney to the scorer's table. We'll get it in a moment for Georgia Tech. Parison will call her own number here, popping a 17-foot jumper from the left of the key that was no good. The rebound through the Wolfpack's Erica Cassell. Front court, Spencer, a lob pass down low to Nelson. Pugh getting tough inside on defense, knocked it away and out of bounds, and Nelson's looking around for the number on that truck that got her.
And Spencer can't believe it. It was a great look by Spencer to Nelson. She went straight to the ref, was like, where's the call for my post player? You know, Nelson's been playing hard, but that may have been a bit dramatic. Pugh got her hand on that ball and was able to knock it away.
Breaking the action, this is our media timeout coming midway through the second quarter here in the McCamish Pavilion in Atlanta. 4:57 to go before halftime. Georgia Tech leads NC State. Foul trouble is the big story. Georgia Tech has this 8-point lead in spite of two fouls on Alo Ada Faroka, Francesca Pond, Imani Tilford, and Zaire O'Neal. And those last two players are especially key for the Yellow Jackets these days. It's very rare that Georgia Tech is going this well with both O'Neal and Tilford on the sideline.
Yeah, and Tilford's been on the sideline for quite some time now. You know, Sweeney and Parison have trying to, you know, play that point guard position for Tilford while she's been out, but fouls are really hurting the Jackets because their big-time scorers are on the bench.
Shea Sweeney is on the floor coming out of the timeout, joining Antonio Parison, Katarina Vucevic, Kaylin Pugh, and Shannon Scott. 10 on the shot clock for the Wolfpack as they get into Nelson, going to the left hand for a rolling hook inside over Vucevic that was no good. Katarina grabs the rebound for the Yellow Jackets. Now here's Sweeney, the little guard at 5 foot 2 inches tall, bringing it forecourt, getting it to Kaylin Pugh. She's the transfer from Ohio State. Left side, Shannon Scott working stop and go behind the Parison pick. They'll hand it off to Sweeney and get a reset of the offense here with the shot clock down to 10. Sweeney lost track of what to do with it and gives it up to Ashley Williams. Williams on the lob inside to Spencer, alley-oop style, and maybe just a little too fancy. Spencer on the run, could not pull it down. She had to worry about the end line right there. She was running out of room.
She did. She was looking, instead of looking for the basket, because the alley-oop, she had to get that up while she was in the air and lost track of the ball, and it went out of bounds.
NC State commits its sixth turnover. Here's Sweeney in the forecourt, handing off to Parison. Parison out court to Pugh, working off of a Vucevic screen to get down inside. A collision with Maya Spencer, and a foul will be called. Kaylin Pugh picks up her first.
Yeah, that was a tough call right there. I thought that was great penetration by Pugh. And Spencer, it looked like, may have gotten there a little late, but ref saw it, and I guess it could have gone either way.
Georgia Tech with their 8-point lead. The Wolfpack with the ball. They lob it down inside, finding a wide-open Erica Cassell. And another local product for the Wolfpack gets involved. Cassell with her first field goal. She's the 6'2"-inch tall freshman out of Marietta. Played her high school ball at the Holy Innocent School.
And that was just too easy. You can't have a player like Cassell that wide open down low for an easy layup. The Jackets have to get back and recover and find players that are in the paint.
It's kind of a low-scoring second quarter. Out top, it's Vucevic trying to work out to Pugh. They dare her to shoot the three. That's not normally her thing. She retreats, shot clock down to two. Racing inside, she gets through for the banker. That's good.
But I love the fake how she brought the basketball up top to set everybody up to make it seem like she was running a play and then just drives it hard to the basket.
Kaylin Pugh has six coming off the bench when the Yellow Jackets have needed it with this foul difficulty. It's 31-23 in favor of Georgia Tech with under 3 minutes to go in the half. Sweeney denying the entry pass, used her feet in the process.
And that was a great job of potentially doubling Sweeney. They knew Cassell wasn't about to shoot a three from outside, so Sweeney just dropped off of her and helped out on Nelson. And Nelson, she almost got the turnover.
NC State will inbound. They've got 15 on the shot clock. Sweeney did sit down on the dead ball. Williams looking around, lobs it down in deep, intended for Nelson. Couldn't get over the top of Scott, and Parison comes through to get the steal. Antonio Parison in the forecourt. A look-away drive to the hoop of her own for a runner that won't go down. Chelsea DeMarish with the rebound. Her stick back won't go. Williams gathers the rebound, floats it forecourt to Spencer. Spencer trying to get an angle for a runner in the lane against Vucevic that's no good. Pugh grabs the rebound, and Kaylin Pugh gets fouled in her own backcourt.
And that was great hustle by Pugh on that rebound. You had Cassell driving in, and it looked like she was going to knock it out of Pugh's hands, but Pugh is strong. She went up for that rebound, grabbed it, and was able to draw the foul.
Foul on Erica Cassell is her first. Four fouls against NC State here in the second quarter. We have 2:24 to go before halftime. Georgia Tech leads NC State 31-23. Kaylin Pugh, stop and go, working into the lane, spinning, leaning in against Spencer. She's called on a travel.
Yes, looks like she was practicing some Zaire O'Neal moves down low, but on that spin, she took an extra step and she gets called for the travel.
Down to 2:12 to go in the second quarter. Forecourt, Dee Dee Rogers gets it, bounces across the lane looking for Spencer. Pugh is in the mix trying to deny what could have been an easy layup if she had not committed the foul.
Yeah, that was great hustle. Pugh was a little bit late. She tried to go for the steal and knock the ball away, but gets called for the foul. But like you said, she prevented an easy layup.
It comes at the price of her second personal foul. That's five Georgia Tech players with two personals now. Michelle Josephs coaching hard over there, but in the back of her mind thinking, if we can just get to halftime with this 8-point lead, it would be a great thing. And a 5-second call on defense will help things out there.
Yeah, that was a great defensive stance again by the Jackets. Right now, NC State, they're looking really, they're unsure about what they should do offensively. They're really trying to force the basketball to Nelson, but most of the time she's doubled down low and they're just getting turnovers.
Shea Sweeney is back out there now to run the point. Pugh again going to the bench with the two fouls. Sweeney working behind DeMarish. Gets inside for a layup. It's good.
And she's quick. We haven't seen her score much lately, but she's doing pretty well this basketball game and taking advantage of her opportunity.
Her second field goal of the night. Georgia Tech with a 10-point lead for the first time. With 1:39 remaining. Down inside, they find Nelson with an angle for a left-hand layup. It's good.
And that was a nice pass right there by Spencer to Nelson. They look for Nelson down low, and she's their number one option, and Spencer's got that basketball tour in a great position to score.
9 points for the junior. Sweeney, the other way, tries a three that's no good off the left wing. The rebound to the Wolfpacks, Dominique Wilson. Out to Williams on the right side. Open to try a three that's good. She, when she gets an open look, is deadly, shooting around 40% from three-point range. She killed the Yellow Jackets in last year's game in Raleigh, and now she's got two threes tonight. It's 33-28. The Georgia Tech lead cut to five with a minute to go in the half. Vucevic out top. turned away by Rogers. Bounce pass to the baseline. Scott trying to get up over two defenders. Their jumper and air ball. Guimarães caught it, stuck it back up and no good. Rogers with the rebound. Now, NC State has used a timeout here in the first half, so they have no use it to lose it to think about. Williams, though, open on the right side, can think about this three and knock it down again.
That's two in a row, and that's somebody you cannot leave open. Wilson's going to her spot at NC State. They are finding her. That's two threes in a row right there for Wilson.
That's the kind of thing that happens when you have only one of your original starters on the floor. Somebody forgets about the game plan, which involves getting after Ashley Williams. Down to 17 seconds to go in the quarter, and a Georgia Tech turnover as Williams takes it away. Now the Wolfpack can play for the final shot of the half. It's a chance to tie it or take the lead with a three. Out court. Here is Spencer trying to drive down inside, and she gets fouled on the way. This will become a shooting foul. It's the fifth foul against the Yellow Jackets.
Well, the Jackets' foul trouble has allowed NC State to get back in this basketball game, and NC State, they're still playing with their starters and playing against Georgia Tech's bench. And like you said, when you have players who aren't used to playing and may not know the entire game plan or have a starter to really tell them to make adjustments, it's been tough. And NC State's made this run to get back in this basketball game.
It's now a 9-0 run as Spencer makes the first of two, and she's not a player Georgia Tech wants to see on the line at this time of the game. She's an 80% free throw shooter. She could tie this game up right now, and Georgia Tech is thinking to themselves, where did the 10-point lead go?
It diminished quickly, and Spencer, she's a very heady player. She's smart, makes good passes, you know, doesn't get too low even when they were down, and she's a pretty calm, settling player for NC State.
Free throw no good. Pond with the rebound. Gets bogged down in the backcourt, and the first half comes to an end. Halftime in Atlanta, and what was once a 10-point Georgia Tech lead, well, now it's a 1-point game at the half, and that is the danger in playing NC State. They are tenacious. They are very good on the road. Your score at the break, the Yellow Jackets 33, the Wolfpack 32.
Yeah, that was a good half by both teams. I'm sure Michelle Joseph doesn't like how the half ended for her team, but at the same time, she had four starters in foul trouble that were on the bench. So for them to still have a 1-point lead going into halftime, that's pretty remarkable against a great NC State team.
Overall, the Yellow Jackets have five players in foul difficulty. They'll welcome this break for halftime here in Atlanta to try and regroup. Again, at the break, the Yellow Jackets lead the Wolfpack by one here at the McCamish Pavilion. Getting set for second half action here in Atlanta as Georgia Tech leads NC State by a single point. It's the Yellow Jackets 33 and the Wolfpack 32. Around the rest of the ACC, there's already a final. Boston College in North Carolina got started early this evening, a 5:30 tip-off in Chapel Hill, and BC wins on the road. The Eagles go to 2-10 in the ACC with an 88-77 victory over the Tar Heels. North Carolina is now just 2-9 on the season in conference play. Kelly Hughes had 24 points, 7 rebounds for the Eagles. Jamie Cherry with 31 points in the losing effort for North Carolina. Fourth quarter, a game that started at 6:30 Eastern time. Clemson on the road looking for another victory, and they lead Pitt by a score of 43-35. Just a week or so ago, we were talking about Clemson being winless in the league, and now they've won two of their last three, trying to make it 3 out of 4. Halftime in Tallahassee, Florida State is tied for the league lead with Notre Dame, each with 10-1 records, and the Seminoles are rolling once again tonight. They lead Wake Forest, and again, this is at the half, 52-27. Florida State's looking to go to 11-1 in conference play. Halftime in Miami. Miami at home in a low-scoring game. There were just 11 points combined by the two teams in the second quarter. And so at halftime, Miami leads Virginia 26-18. Into the third quarter at Blacksburg, Louisville on the road leads Virginia Tech 42-35. And again, as you talk about the big picture in the ACC, Notre Dame off tonight. They don't play again until Sunday when they play host to Georgia Tech in South Bend. And that, by the way, will be a play-for-K game on Sunday. Notre Dame is going to wear home whites with pink trim, and so Georgia Tech will bring these same pink uniforms with them on the road and wear them once again on Sunday. Again, this entire month of February is very much a tribute to Kay Yao, and of course in the ACC, her memory is so dear to all fans.
Oh, it is, and you know, anytime you can pay tribute to such a pioneer to women's basketball, it's huge, and you have to applaud the ACC for how they've made this a tremendous month for Kay Yao ever since her passing.
All right, to begin the second half, the Yellow Jackets will get some of those players back on the floor who were saddled with the foul difficulty, namely Imani Tilford and Zaire O'Neal. See how NC State comes out in just a moment. They have very little to worry about in terms of foul trouble. It was only Jennifer Mazzarine who picked up two fouls in the first half.
Yeah, it's going to be key early for O'Neal and Tilford and for Pond to get, even at a Faroka, get back into this ball game. The only one who saw a lot of minutes was Vucevic, who did not have two fouls in that first half. So it's going to be key for those four players to get adjusted and get back into the basketball game in the second half.
Those four players that Fallon mentioned, all with the two personal fouls, as they get set to play defense here to begin the second half of play. Georgia Tech defending the Fowler Street end of McCamish Pavilion here in the second half. Maya Spencer working it to the foul line for Dominique Wilson to try a jumper that's no good. Pond gets after the rebound and will bring it forecourt. She'll step up to the three-point line and try it. Sees it's way off the mark, tries to get after her own rebound. There's a foul in there. Let's see who it goes against. It will be against Georgia Tech. They're waiting breathlessly to find out the foul call from Ed Sidlaski, and it is against Zaire O'Neal. That's probably the worst case scenario for the Yellow Jacket. She has her third, not even 30 seconds into the third quarter.
Yeah, and I see Pond. She saw the wide open three and went for it. Good hustle, but sometimes you want to give your post players an opportunity to get position before you take those threes.
O'Neal sits down, replaced by Kaylin Pugh. NC State has the ball game for their first lead of the evening. There's a three from the left wing by Jennifer Mazzarine that's no good. Rebound though to Nelson. Chelsea Nelson will send it back out. Gordon, this becomes an extended trip down the floor for the Wolfpack. Feed it to the low post. Nelson turned away by Pond. Out to Spencer on the left side. The three from Maya Spencer is good.
Yeah, Spencer, like I said in the first half, she's a very heady player. She makes good decisions. She was wide open on that three. The Jackets didn't adjust, and she was able to knock it down.
NC State takes its first lead of the night at 35-33 into the second minute of play here in the second half. Tilford gets down inside, misses the banker. Ada Faroka steps to the other side after grabbing the rebound and lays it up off the left side and good.
Great penetration by Tilford, but another great play by Ada Faroka to have her back and get that offensive rebound and get the putback.
Tied at 35 in the high post. Nelson gets in the foul line, spinning inside on Pond for a turnaround that's no good. Rebound, Pugh flying to the ball. Get the foul call against NC State's Jennifer Mazzarine. It's her third.
And she's not happy. She's going to have to go right back to the bench, but that's great hustle right there by Pugh. She saw that offensive rebound, went in there hard, and was able to get the foul drawn.
Mazzarine sits. We have not got a chance to really see what she is all about this evening. The 6'1" tall senior from Montreal, one of three players from that Canadian city in the ACC this year. Here's Tilford working stop and go. Out to Pugh. Again, they segue off her. She's not known at all as a three-point shooting threat. Tried to bounce it into Ada Faroka, and the pass off the mark out of bounds to NC State.
And that wasn't a really good decision right there by Pugh. You have three players in a zone on Ada Faroka. They're covering her, and she tried to zip that ball in. Sometimes you have to make a few passes in that zone to get to the wide-open player.
NC State will look to regain the lead. A slick behind-the-back move by Spencer to penetrate. Out to Williams. Wide-open three ball, don't you know, is good.
And that's something that was happening in the first half. Williams gets a wide-open three. She's going to knock it down. The Jackets have to rotate or have somebody looking out for her and have her covered.
When she's got that kind of time, I'll put my money on her every time to knock it down. She's got 12 points now, and NC State with a three-point lead of 38-35. 7:38 remaining here in the third quarter. The shot clock's under 10. Tilford trying to make something happen. Can't get anywhere against Williams. Dobbs it inside to Ada Faroka for a turnaround that's no good. Rebound. Tilford was trying to reach around Spencer. Tilford wound up on the deck.
She did, and that's just great active play. You know, Tilford's always active. She's going to be in the mix somehow, and somehow she's able to draw the foul on Williams going for that rebound.
Williams picks up her second. Shire O'Neal back in there with the three fouls inbound to the Yellow Jackets. The Parasol tried to get right back to O'Neal, but defended nicely by Dee Dee Rogers in the low post. Wolfpack come the other way. Pass, though, broken up by Tilford as she took away a potential layup and comes out the other way. Bounce pass to O'Neal, going up for a banker that gets the roll over Chelsea Nelson.
And that's something Tilford has to do. She has the speed to control this game. She needs to push it hard against those guards for NC State, and she's going to find the open player.
Dominique Wilson drives out of the left corner, getting in for a layup that's good.
And that was another great baseline move right there by Wilson. She just took it hard to the basket, didn't settle for that three-point shot that time, and was able to score.
Dominique Wilson, a senior out of Powder Springs, who began her collegiate career at Arkansas before transferring to NC State, and she's had a great career for the Wolfpack. It's a three-point NC State lead of 40-37. Ada Faroka gets it on the right baseline for a short turnaround jumper that rolled off the iron, no good. Rebound to Maya Spencer. Spencer drives the middle of the floor all the way down inside against Vucevic. Took the bump, got the layup to go, and she will go to the line, try to complete a three-point play.
Yeah, that was a tough play right there by Vucevic. They had her turned around. Spencer had her turned around when she was penetrating with that basketball, taking it coast to coast, and she's able to finish the play, and now she's at the free throw line for one.
Spencer, again, very good body control to finish. She has 9 points now in the game. She's within 59 points here in her senior season of reaching 1,500 for her NC State career.
And that's amazing. That's a lot of scoring, especially playing in the ACC.
Free throws good. She has 10 now, the second Wolfpack player in the double figures. NC State trailed by 10 at one time in the first half. Now they lead by 6 here early in the second half. It is 43-37 with 6:24 to go in the third quarter. Tilford out to Antonio Parasol, holding overhead. Left corner to Tilford, lobbing it down inside where Zaire O'Neal was looking to post up. And O'Neal was getting pushed around a little bit.
Yeah.
Fouls on Chelsea Nelson, only her first.
And anytime you can draw one on Nelson, I'm sure the Jackets are happy about that, because you have to hold your breath when it's Nelson and O'Neal, with O'Neal having three fouls now.
Tilford lobs it into O'Neal, working against Nelson once again. Over two defenders, she'll put up a banker that's no good. Scott with the athletic rebound, got fouled as she went back up.
She's just amazing to watch sometimes, you know. Scott will come out of nowhere and get some great offensive rebounds, and she just skies for that one and is able to try and go back up and draw the foul. So that was great hustle right there after O'Neal, who looked like she got fouled as well on her shot, able to recover.
A couple of Charlotte natives right there involved. Rogers committing her first, putting Shannon Scott at the free throw line, where her first is a little too hard. First miss of the evening for the Yellow Jackets. Scott had not missed in a while. She had a streak of 7 in a row going for her that had moved her from below 50% of the free throw shooter to above 50%, but she missed the second one as well. Rogers claims the rebound for NC State. Still a 6-point lead for the Wolfpack as we move down to 6 minutes remaining in the third quarter. Out court, Maya Spencer. Left wing, Dee Dee Rogers with it. Scott all over her. Cross court to Wilson, getting a skip off the right wing, driving in between defenders and losing the handle. Ball to the floor. Nelson keeps it alive. Just 3 on the shot clock. They'll work it right side for Spencer to heave up a 3 that's no good. Rebound, though, to Rogers. Right back to Spencer, and she says, let's calm it down for a moment.
Like I said, Spencer's a very heady player. That was just unfortunate for the Jackets right there. They had several opportunities to try and recover and get that basketball, and when you work so hard to get the shot clock down, NC State's able to get the offensive rebound.
In the lane for Nelson on her turnaround over O'Neal, that's no good. Rebound knocked around. Pugh comes away for Georgia Tech. Pugh driving the lane, bounced to Tilford, trying to squeeze between defenders. Kathleen Lynch will call her on a travel.
Yeah, that was a travel right there. I don't think Tilford was expecting it, but Pugh, she had Parasol in the left wing that she could have passed that ball to, and she just missed that look.
Georgia Tech commits its 11th turnover. A lead pass finding. Wilson behind the defense for a layup that's good. A breakdown by Georgia Tech on defense.
Yeah, when they were playing that zone, they didn't recover. You have to rotate because someone could be wide open underneath the basket, and that's exactly what happened right there.
Michelle Joseph can't like what she's seen of late. NC State's gone on a 7-0 run. Georgia Tech is in a scoring drought, which has lasted more than 2 minutes right now, and it will prompt the Yellow Jackets head coach to take a timeout ahead of the media timeout. We have 4:49 to go, third quarter here in Atlanta. It's now NC State 45 and Georgia Tech 37. NC State is without freshman Aislinn Koenig, a 5'9" tall product of Surrey, British Columbia. We've talked the last couple of games. Players from Toronto have become prominent around the ACC. From Montreal, thinking of Jennifer Mottarine. And the Vancouver area has its own little basketball situation going on. The Raptors' success kind of spreads nationwide. They are a national team in Canada. And you can kind of see how it is spreading from coast to coast. And the women's game is benefiting from it as well.
They are. And even on both sides, between the NBA, you know, men's college basketball, women's college basketball, you're starting to see a lot of good players come out of Canada. And they're playing extremely well.
We'll see what Georgia Tech can do coming out of this timeout. Imani Tilford starts the offense to Chan and Scott. You also got Ayla Ada Faroka, Zaire O'Neal, and Antonio Perrison out there. Here's O'Neal getting it down inside, trying to work against D.D. Rogers. Rogers fouled her as O'Neal got some position down inside. You may have some height on Zaire O'Neal, but she is so strong, you don't have her where you want her.
Oh, you don't. And that's her advantage right there. And also her quick feet. When you think about, she's usually playing against taller post players, be her being an undersized post player, but she has great strength. She can break players down.
The foul on Rogers, her second. NC State's over the limit, and Zaire O'Neal will be at the free throw line when we continue from here in Atlanta. 4:38 to go in the third quarter at McCamish Pavilion in Atlanta as NC State, ranked 17th in the nation, leads Georgia Tech 45-37, a game that Georgia Tech led by as many as 10 in the late stages of the first half. The Yellow Jackets are now trying to get back on track. Zaire O'Neal will be going to the free throw line. And again, O'Neal playing with the three fouls. They've got to go to her, though, if they're going to get back in this one. She is such a key piece in the way Georgia Tech has been playing of late. It all kind of got rolling in the second half of that game at Virginia, a game in which O'Neal wound up with 24 points in an overtime loss, and then it just kept right on going this past Sunday when she was spectacular against Virginia Tech.
Yeah, and against Virginia Tech, she had a cool 25, so she's had a great week. But she started this game off extremely well, but then foul trouble just plagued her again, and she was forced to go to the bench. And like you said, the Jackets are going to have to ride her. Hopefully she can continue this streak at the free throw line, and this can get her going again in the second half. They're going to need her point production if they want to win this ball game.
Zaire O'Neal shoots two here. She began the night at 56% from the free throw line, but she's riding a 10-for-10 free throw shooting streak. Misses the first, however.
It's funny how when you say that, that sometimes just jinx the rhythm and the streak.
But I amaze myself sometimes. The second for O'Neal is good. Let's hope she starts a new streak right there. Georgia Tech trails NC State 45-38. Point guard is Maya Spencer, looking to drive on Tilford. Got down inside but missed the runner. Tilford played her cleanly on defense, even with the two fouls. And on the scramble for the rebound, we got a whistle from Pulani Spurlock. There will be a foul call here, however, against Tilford. And there is her third foul.
That's something you don't want Tilford to get either. But these fouls have been plaguing the Jackets all evening. They just got to play basketball and try and get back in this game.
Quick hitter on the inbound. They got it into Nelson going up between defenders, and she gets fouled.
And NC State, they're just playing smart basketball right now. They know the Jackets are in foul trouble. And Nelson, that was just a great cut on the out-of-bounds play, and she's able to draw the foul.
It's the third on Shannon Scott as she tried to go up there and contend with Nelson, who misses the first free throw. So for Georgia Tech, they've got O'Neal, Tilford, and now Scott with three fouls. Scott's going to sit down. Tilford and O'Neal remain on the floor as Nelson gets ready for her second free throw. That's good for the junior from Antioch, Tennessee. She's got 10 points now. Three NC State players in what is generally a very balanced offense are in double figures, and we're only in the third quarter. 4:20 to go, third period. Kaylin Pugh trying to drive, getting down inside, made contact with Spencer, and that was enough to cause the traveling violation. Another Georgia Tech turnover, giving the ball back to NC State. The Wolfpack's eight-point lead is intact.
And that's been a couple of possessions for Pugh this evening where she's penetrated and been unsure about what she wants to do, and she's caused a turnover. She has to know when she's going to that lane, if she's going to put that basketball up or she's going to get rid of it with the pass.
12 Georgia Tech turnovers for the game. That's even after playing the first quarter without a turnover. Spencer trying to drive on O'Neal, and O'Neal had to play soft. Spencer gets right in there for the layup. It's good.
She did, and like I said, Spencer's a heady player. She gave O'Neal a little shimmy shake and drove that basketball to the lane and was able to finish the play.
You can watch as this night goes along. Westmore is watching matchups very carefully, and it's a couple of times they've tried to get O'Neal into trouble and capitalize on the three fouls she already has. 48-38. NC State has a 10-point lead of their own now as Tilford gets down inside. Scooping one high off the glass and good.
And she just surprises you every night. She goes in the lane, looks like she's going to get lost down there, and she's able to get that basketball high on the goal and able to convert and score.
NC State 48, Georgia Tech 40 with 3:13 to go in the third quarter. They run the two post players out high. Spencer comes over to the left wing on the angle. That opens space in the middle to drive on Tilford. Tilford got the hand in there, disrupted the layup, and it goes out of bounds to Georgia Tech. That was a great sequence right there by Tilford on defense.
Yeah, just a play on one possession. She finishes with the layup, and back on defense, she's able to get the turnover against Spencer. Great defense. Tilford's so quick that her reaction time, players don't expect it, but she's able to get a hand on the basketball.
And again, in my mind, that was isolation designed to try and get the fourth foul on Tilford, and she didn't bite. In the lane, it's Vucevic getting it. Trying to squeeze between defenders, going to the left hand for a layup. It's no good. The rebound to Dee Dee Rogers for NC State. Wolfpack on forecourt with the 8-point lead. Skip it out to the right wing. Here's Williams faking, driving baseline. A pull-up mid-range jumper is no good. The rebound to Katarina Vucevic for the Yellow Jackets.
And maybe that's the shot that Williams can't hit. Great job to drive her off that three-point line and force her to take a mid-range J.
Williams keeps Tilford from turning the corner and going deep inside. Back out to the wing for Antonio Parison on the right wing. She'll work off the screen out high, offered by Alo Ada Faroka. Wilson tried to barrel through that screen and gets called on her second foul.
And that's something the Jackets have to continue to do. They got to pass, penetrate, try and force it on NC State to put them on their heels a bit, force them to make fouls and commit some plays or commit some fouls on the defensive end.
Wolfpack are over the limit, and so puts Antonio Parison, very solid free throw shooter at the line, where her first is good. Antonio getting close to 75% for the year. She's made her last four free throw attempts. Second is good. She went 2 for 2.
Parison's just a good all-around shooter. You know, she can shoot from the free throw line, and she can definitely shoot the three. Let's see if the Jackets can get her going at some point.
Georgia Tech is within six. It's 48-42 with 2:14 to go in the third quarter. Spencer moves it down to the right baseline for Nelson, trying to turn on Ada Faroka for a post-up jumper that was no good. Vucevic with another rebound for the Yellow Jackets. She's got four of them now on the night. Here's Tilford working stop and go. Got into the defense a little bit, now retreats. Goes back to work on penetration, getting out to Vucevic on the left side. Down low to O'Neal for a layup. It's good.
And that was a great pass. Great play right there by Vucevic to set that up. She gave a little head fake and was able to make the pass back to O'Neal on the block for the layup.
NC State has not scored in more than 2 minutes. Georgia Tech has capitalized with a 6-0 run. It's 48-44. With 1:35 to go in the third quarter. Spencer isolated, jump shoots over O'Neal and is way short. Parison with the rebound, waits for the traffic to clear and leaves it for Imani Tilford. Michelle Joseph with the play call off of the Georgia Tech bench for her point guard as Tilford brings it around the right side in this horn set. Bob it down low to Vucevic behind the defense for a layup. It's good.
Spencer knew it. She was fronting Vucevic, but Vucevic definitely had the height advantage, and Tilford noticed it, gave a nice lob pass, easy layup for Vucevic.
The 5'8 guard was no match for the 6'3 post player. A turnover by Spencer. The pass was deflected and taken away by the Yellow Jackets, who now have a chance to tie it up or maybe take the lead on a three. Down to 50 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Down low, nice entry pass to O'Neal, getting behind Rogers off the Vucevic feed, and the layup is good. We are tied at 48.
And that's another great pass by Vucevic. Her height advantage is really helping the Jackets right now because she's able to look over the defense, the guards for NC State, and make great passes to the post.
Both teams have seen 10-point leads disappear. Williams the other way, a three-pointer way off the mark, hitting glass only, wide right, if you will. The rebound to Alo Ada Faroka.
And those are the threes you want Williams to take when someone's in her face. That's a great rotation by the Jackets right there.
Shot clock turned off with 15 seconds remaining in the third quarter. Tilford brings it around the double screen out high, dragging it to the right wing, down to 8 seconds. Caparison out top, getting vocal, trying to get some help from Ada Farokas. Caparison stop and go in some trouble. Throws up a runner at the foul line that was blocked as the buzzer sounds to end the third quarter of play. We've played 30 minutes so far, haven't settled anything. The game is tied. It's the Yellow Jackets 48, NC State 48.
And that was a great recovery, great way for them to end that third quarter.
Fourth quarter coming up in a moment from here in Atlanta. In the third quarter, Georgia Tech 6 of 13 shooting, 46%. They're at 43% for the evening, now 19 of 44 on their field goal tries. NC State was 6 out of 17 in the third quarter. They hit a scoring drought in the final minutes of the third period, which allowed Georgia Tech to turn it around and tie this game up. Rebounding, Georgia Tech is now plus 8 for the game. They've out-rebounded NC State 31-23. They went plus 4 in the third quarter alone on the rebounding. Georgia Tech with 12 turnovers on the night, and NC State with 10 turnovers in the game so far. Another final from around the league. Clemson does win on the road. They go to 3-9 in conference play now, beating Pitt 54-46. Clemson's entitled to do some scoreboard watching these days. They're making their way up out of the basement in
the
ACC.
Are. They've been playing well the last couple of weeks and putting up some good ACC wins with the young team that they have in South Carolina.
Third quarter, or I should say fourth quarter, begins with Imani Tilford running the Georgia Tech offense. Get it to Zaire O'Neal, backing cautiously in the lane for a pull-up jumper that's good.
And she's feeling it right now. She's feeling confident. She has 19 points in this ball game, and she's basically helped Georgia Tech regain this lead.
50-48 in favor of the Yellow Jackets in the opening minute of the fourth quarter. Out top, Williams. They get after her in a hurry. Ada Farokas on her. Down inside to Nelson for a turnaround that's no good. Ada Farokas jumps down low and grabs the rebound.
And you see Nelson upset. She couldn't finish that play. You knew that's where NC State was going. She's their go-to player. Unfortunately, she wasn't able to connect on the easy two.
Antonio Parison works the dribble around the left side of the floor to Vucevic. Down in the low post, Ada Farokas posting up on Nelson. Gets the drop step inside for a left-hand finish that's good.
And that's just icing on the cake when you have Ada Farokas able to hit baskets and score down low for the Jackets. She's a good heads-up basketball player, but when she's scoring, that makes them even better.
Ada Farokas, 6'2 junior from Nigeria, trying to defend down inside as Wilson gets all the way in for a jump stop and a layup that's good.
And Wilson's been pretty quiet since we saw her score last, maybe in the third quarter, but that's a good play. You know, the NC State guards, they're going to be looking to score in this fourth quarter to see if they can pull out this win on the road.
Wilson is the fourth NC State starter to get into double figures. It's a two-point game in favor of Georgia Tech. Vucevic in the low post. They try and double down on her. Out to the foul circle for Ada Farokas, open for a jumper that is no good. O'Neal had position for the rebound. Let's see who the foul is against. I suspect it may be against Jennifer Mazzarine, and if that's the case, it's her fourth. That is the case. It is her fourth. She just hasn't been able to get anything going tonight.
She hasn't, and she's been struggling with the fouls all evening and has been on the bench most of this game, but now her coach is sticking with her. It's the fourth quarter. She's staying out there.
8:29 to go in the fourth. Georgia Tech trying to add to a 52-50 lead. Parison, touch pass down to the right of the lane. O'Neal kicking it out to the left corner for Tilford to pump up a long jumper that's no good. The rebound taken away by Dominique Wilson for NC State. Wilson shakes to the left of the lane. A pull-up jumper is an air ball caught by Zaire O'Neal. Back the other way we come. Imani Tilford darting quickly into the forecourt, setting up at the top of the key. Left wing foul line extended. It's Vucevic and now to Tilford out between the circles. You've also got Ada Farokas, O'Neal, and Parison in the half court for the Yellow Jackets. Tilford working stop and go. Bounce it into O'Neal. They try and double down on her. She turns, pumps it up over the double team and good.
That's just strength. That's core strength. She was doubled, was able to get the ball and still finish the play. Great job by Zaire O'Neal.
Spencer raced back the other way and missed the layup. Rebound out of bounds to Georgia Tech. Yellow Jackets trying to get some momentum going behind Zaire O'Neal. They've built a four-point lead at 54-50 with 7:40 remaining.
They are riding O'Neal, and as they should. She's playing extremely well right now and is able to score down low for the Jackets. And NC State, they don't have an answer for her right now.
Antonio Parison's turn to run the offense here out top. High post to O'Neal, working on Nelson again. Stop and go into the lane. Pumps up a fallaway jumper that rolls around no good. Ada Farokas with the rebound. Spencer tried to reach it and tie it up. only to get called on her second foul.
And Spencer right there was close to getting teed up. She was yelling right in the ref's face saying she didn't foul, but you could tell NC State getting a little flustered, a little frustrated with the foul calls and the missed shots, and the Jackets are continuing to try and capitalize.
Spencer again with her second, a non-shooting foul. Tilford quickly into Vucevic on the baseline for a turnaround that's no good from the right of the lane. The rebound to Chelsea Nelson. NC State trying to get some things going once again. They trail by four. Here's Mathurin with it on the right side. Fake against Ada Faroka, driving inside. A collision, no call, except ball out of bounds to NC State.
Yeah, Mathurin, that was pretty brave of her to drive that basketball like that, because she could have easily been called for the offensive foul.
Zaire O'Neal standing in there tough as well. That's a couple players right now that have to be cautious. Try to avoid whistles. Mathurin especially with the four fouls. O'Neal's got three of her own. 7:06 to go in this game. There's 18 on the shot clock for the Wolfpack. They need a moment to mop the floor, and Wes Moore is also taking this as an opportunity to talk to his team here about what they are going to run in the half court. They get it into Williams quickly in the right corner. They've learned their lessons about her to get after her at three-point range. Out to Spencer and turn to Wilson. Rotated out top to Nelson. Now to Mathurin. Fakes the three, drives around Parasol, getting in for a banker with the shot clock running down. It was no good. Rebound, though, recovered by Spencer, and NC State will reset. Spencer's had a knack for finding some offensive rebounds tonight.
She has. She's been in the right place at the right time, but that's something the Jackets have to be aware of. Those long rebounds, they have to hustle and box out.
Wilson's going to try a three. Parison with the rebound, had it knocked loose. Nelson was the one hustling there, knocked the ball loose, but then in that second effort to get after it, she picks up her second foul.
Yeah, that's Nelson trying to make something happen. Fortunately, she's not in foul trouble for NC State, but she gets called for the easy foul, but at least stops a potential fast break for the Jackets.
It is the third team foul against the Wolfpack. Georgia Tech has not committed a foul so far in the fourth quarter. That's saying something. From a Georgia Tech team that is in the top 10 in the nation in fouls per game committed. Down low, it's Vucevic getting it on the right block, turning on Spencer for the jumper that's no good. Rebound tipped around. Vucevic regained. Out top to Paris on to Comley. Pump up a three that's no good. Scott with an offensive rebound. In a crowded black jersey, she puts it back up and no good. The rebound to Chelsea Nelson for the Wolfpack.
Yeah, Scott learned something right there. That was a great offensive rebound, but sometimes you need to set it back up.
Here's Spencer going to work as we move under 6 minutes remaining in the game. Spencer outcourt to Williams at deep three-point range. Skip it back to the left side for Wilson. Left corner to Mathurin, turned away by Parasol. To Wilson once again, trying to drive inside, a collision with Imani Tilford, who's going to get called on the foul right there, and that is her fourth.
That's unfortunate. Tilford did lay her body on the line, but wasn't well positioned to try and get that charge, and it was a great drive right there by Wilson. Easy call for the ref.
Monty Tilford's got to pick herself back up off the floor and head to the bench. Get the sub as Zaire O'Neal returns. Inbound for NC State with the fresh shot clock. 5:44 remaining in the game. Spencer behind her back drives inside against Parasol for the bucket and the foul.
And what a play. Spencer with the penetration behind the back and then is able to convert on the layup. That was a great take and draw the foul.
Antonio Parison had her hands full right there, trying to keep up with Spencer, especially on a move like that behind the back dribble in traffic. First foul on Antonio Parison. Spencer knocks the free throw in. It is her third and one tonight, and she's got 15 points on the game. A one-point contest here in Atlanta, 54-53 in favor of Georgia Tech with 5.5 minutes to go. Parasol stopping out beyond the top of the key to Alo Ada Farouk at the left elbow. Trying to force it to Vucevic, but knocked away. The Wolfpack come away with a steal. Williams ahead to Spencer, driving again for a banker that is no good. Rebound, Scott got it and got clipped in the face as she tried to break away from the crowd.
Another great rebound by Scott, but that was great defense getting back for the Jackets, because you had Spencer right there who was going to the basket strong again, trying to convert and give NC State the lead again, and they were able to get the stop. She misses the layup.
The foul is on Jennifer Mathurin, the senior from Montreal. Fouls out with 5:18 to go in the game. First time this year she's fouled out. We never really got a chance to see what she's about in this game. Foul trouble just totally took her out of things.
Yeah, and that's a great job by the Jackets. Obviously on the scouting report, they realize what she could possibly do for this team, a very balanced scoring NC State team, and they were able to get her in foul trouble early.
Monterine was scoreless, had only one rebound and one assist. Here's Tilford driving down low, got around Williams, who resorts to fouling. The layup does not count. Williams got her just in time, but it is her third personal.
And it's amazing. Tilford, she's so low to the ground, but she pounds that basketball so hard like a post player taking a drop step and is able to get by a lot of guards in the ACC and find opportunities to get to the hole to score.
Some question about the foul call. The PA inadvertently announced that it was on Maya Spencer, who wears number 3. It should instead be on number 4, as we saw Ashley Williams. It's Williams' third personal. Ultimately, it puts Imani Tilford at the free throw line, and she is looking so confident now. A player who could understandably have been shaken by missed free throws in the clutch at both Wake Forest and Virginia, but she has turned it around. She has now made 10 free throws in a row over the last couple of games, including 4 for 4 tonight. Georgia Tech leads NC State 56-53.
And her free throws have been huge. Obviously, you see a difference and a refocus when you have two tough games where you miss free throws like that. She's definitely made the adjustment. It's been big.
Miljack is trying to protect a 3-point lead here as they move under 5 minutes remaining in the game. Spencer on the right side, down to the right of the lane for Nelson. Turning on the right baseline for the jumper that's no good. Rebound claimed by Shannon Scott for the Yellow Jackets. Here's Parison into the forecourt. Tilford is getting a breather right now in anticipation of the coming media timeout. Parison hands it off to Scott. Now off the O'Neal screen. She gets to the foul circle and stops. To Vucevic on the left wing. Down to 13 on the shot clock as they work it to O'Neal. They try to double down on O'Neal for a moment. Kicks it out to Ada Faroka inside the foul line for a jumper that rolls around no good. O'Neal had inside position on Rogers for the rebound. Ball wound up being knocked away from O'Neal and out of bounds to the Yellow Jackets.
And O'Neal's doing a great job, even with her foul trouble. She's still hustling, trying to put a body on players to get rebounds. And she was fighting for that one and was able to get the possession back for the Jackets.
It brings us to the media timeout we spoke of, the final scheduled timeout of the evening. It's a 3-point game here in Atlanta. Georgia Tech trying to upset nationally ranked NC State. For Georgia Tech, Imani Tilford will remain on the bench with her 4 fouls. Georgia Tech has Parison, Ada Faroka, Scott, and O'Neal on the floor. And a fresh shot clock to work with. Inbound to Katarina Vucevic. Out of Chan and Scott, the freshman bring it out court and leaving it for her point guard. Against the NC State defense, the zone, they'll work it to Ada Faroka at the foul line. To Vucevic in the left corner. Down low, O'Neal trying to work on Dede Rogers. Puts it up and good.
And you know what's amazing? You had Dede Rogers and you also had Williams right there, or Nelson right there with Zaire O'Neal, and she's still able to connect and score.
Zaire has 23 points. Meanwhile, Wilson drives for a reverse layup with the left hand that's good. 13 points for Dominique Wilson. In a game in which she comes home to her home territory, hailing from Powder Springs. It's been unusual for the NC State seniors. They've played 3 games here in Atlanta in 4 years' time. O'Neal finds Vucevic down inside for a post-up layup. It's no good. Williams with the rebound.
That was a great pass by O'Neal, and that's something that Vucevic has connect on. That was an easy layup that she just missed.
3:25 to go in the game. NC State could tie it on a 3 still. There's the drive by Wilson, and she winds up getting fouled as she went down in deep. That was on Zaire O'Neal. It is her 4th. So now Georgia Tech very much in dangerous territory. Imani Tilford's on the bench with 4 fouls. Zaire O'Neal will continue to play with 4 fouls, and 3:22 to go in the game. Here is Spencer out court, watched by Parison. Spencer trying to work down inside to the baseline for a running one-hander that's no good. O'Neal with the rebound for Georgia Tech. Down to 3:07 to go in the game. The Jackets with the ball and the 3-point advantage. Here's Parison out between the circles as they get the offense set up. Left side, Vucevic looking in from the angle. Fade it down to O'Neal on the left block. Turning, going to the right hand for a jump hook that's no good. Nelson flew to the rebound for the Wolfpack.
And that was great hustle right there by Nelson. She was ready to get that offensive board and get NC State up and running to get down the floor to see if they can score.
Wilson turned away initially by Vucevic, stays on the dribble, crosses over, getting to the baseline, going reverse for another layup that's good in amongst 3 pink jerseys.
I mean, Wilson is a good player. I mean, she's hit a couple of baskets these last couple of possessions, and she's got NC State right back in this ball game, down by one.
58-57, Stott avoided the steal attempt by Wilson, settles it down to Vucevic. Now left side to Harrison, looking over her shoulder for the play call from her coach, Michelle Joseph. Left elbow to O'Neal, handing it to Vucevic in the foul circle for a 17-foot jumper that's no good. The rebound to Chelsea Nelson for NC State.
And O'Neal had to be careful right there. She could have easily been called for an over the back, but Nelson was able to secure the rebound.
Spencer drives down low, whips it out to Wilson. Wilson trying to drive in on the left side. Had the shot blocked by Vucevic, but a foul as well.
And that's a tough call. She was moving back. Vucevic had her arms up, but unfortunately she gets called for that foul as Wilson was penetrating and trying to get to the basket.
Stops the clock with 1:49 remaining. So Katarina Vucevic there with her second foul. And Dominique Wilson, the 86% free throw shooter this year, will try and tie the game up with the first of two. It is good. It's not as though she's picked up her free throw shooting here in her senior year. She's an 84% free throw shooter for her career. She's been good from day one at the line.
And that's amazing because she shoots threes, but she also drives the basketball to the basket, so you know she gets to the line quite a bit.
Now for the lead, Wilson connects, and NC State goes back on top. It's 59-58 with 1:48 remaining. The clock moving here in Atlanta. Imani Tilford's back on the floor playing with the four fouls. Tilford will start the offense to the left side. Antonio Parison with it. Left corner to Scott. Jannon Scott cautiously to the left of the lane. Out top to Ada Faroka. Shot clock to 13. They put it back in Tilford's hands to call out a new play in the half court. Shot clock down to 8. Tilford being overplayed by Williams. Drives to her left. Gets down inside for a scoop. It's no good. Rebound goes out of bounds. It's going to be NC State ball. Even if it had gone Georgia Tech's way, the shot clock would have been down to 1 as that runner failed to hit the iron.
Yeah, and Jackets need to find or get something better in their offense. That was a tough shot for Tilford with the shot clock running down. She had to take that shot. And this close in the game, they need to get a better look at the basket.
1:07 to go. Here is Spencer trying to find some isolation. Gets down inside for a runner over Ada Faroka that's no good. But Rogers with a huge offensive rebound. NC State will continue on offense as we're under a minute remaining in the game. They will put it right back in Spencer's hands. Down to 49 seconds. Georgia Tech trailing by a point. Need a big stand on defense. Spencer trying to work in around Scott. There's contact and the foul call on Shannon Scott will be her fourth foul. And both teams are over the limit. No coincidence that it was in Dominique Wilson's hands right there. If someone's going to get fouled, NC State wants it to be this player right here. We already spoke of how great a free throw shooter she is.
And that's a smart senior. She knew what she needed to do once she got the basketball in her hands. She was going to penetrate. She was able to draw the foul and get right back to the free throw line.
Wilson's first is good. She has 18 points, including 3 for 3 at the line in the last minute.
And it seems like a quiet 18. She really picked it up in this fourth quarter and has hit some big buckets and free throws for NC State to extend their lead.
She has 9 points in the fourth quarter alone. Free throw good. She is automatic at the line. Georgia Tech wants timeout so they can advance the ball to the front court. But NC State now has built a 3-point lead. And keep in mind, Georgia Tech, if you're thinking about a 3-to-tie, they've made only 1 3 so far tonight. It's not their strong suit.
It's not, and they're not shooting the basketball behind the arc like they did on Sunday against Virginia Tech. But they haven't taken as many threes as it took against Virginia Tech either. But they're going to need a 3 at this point. They still have some time, so maybe they can get a quick 2 and see if they can play some strong defense against NC State and get another opportunity. That might be an opportunity for them.
Resetting, the possession arrow does favor NC State. Georgia Tech has 1 timeout remaining. It is a 30. NC State has 3 timeouts remaining. A 60 and a pair of 30s for Wes Moore to use strategically. On the scoreboard in the ACC, late fourth quarter, Florida State at home, leading Wake Forest 98-58. 2 minutes to go in the fourth quarter in Coral Gables. Miami leading Virginia 54-39. A minute and a half remaining in the fourth quarter at Blacksburg. Louisville with a big fourth quarter leads Virginia Tech 85-70. The closest game of all in the ACC is right here in Atlanta. NC State 61, Georgia Tech 58. Yellow Jackets are inbound from the 28-foot line on the left side of the floor. And Imani Tilford will do the honors as her teammates break into some motion. Inbound to Zaire O'Neal. O'Neal starts to go to work and gets fouled out court.
And that was a good decision by O'Neal to drive that basketball and get to the free throw line, and hopefully she can connect on these two to cut this lead to one, and it gives the Jackets enough time for at least another possession.
Zaire O'Neal will shoot two. She's 5 out of 6 shooting free throws tonight. It's the third straight game in which she has had 23 points or more. 24 points now. That's becoming the new normal for Zaire O'Neal. 24 against Virginia, 25 against Virginia Tech, 24 now against NC State. Trying to make it a one-point game. She goes 2 for 2 when the Jackets needed it most. And NC State will take one of those 3 timeouts we spoke of.
And that was a great job right there. Zaire O'Neal, they were looking for Parison in the corner. She wasn't open. You know NC State was all over her. And Zaire stepped up, got the inbound pass, and just drove to the basket to draw the foul and connects on the 2 free throws to cut NC State's lead to 1.
This is a 30-second timeout. So Wes Moore, with his team huddled up around him, has a 60 and a 30 remaining. Michelle Joseph talking to her team. She has a 30-second timeout remaining. For NC State, of course, they can move the ball to the front court and avoid Georgia Tech pressure in the process.
They can, but this gives Georgia Tech an opportunity. They don't have to foul. They can play good heads-up defense and get that shot clock down a bit for NC State and see if they can score.
42 8/10 seconds remaining. NC State 61, Georgia Tech 60. They'll inbound it to Williams, tried to get it back to Spencer, turned it over, the steal by Katarina Vucevic. Now Georgia Tech with a chance to take the lead, and a timeout taken by the Yellow Jackets. A breakdown on the inbound play by the Wolfpack. They've got to be kicking themselves right now.
But look who it was again, Tilford getting the hands up and was able to get that steal. And fortunately, Vucevic was able to recover. She almost turned it back over, but was able to get the ball to Parison so they could call the timeout.
At the other end, Tilford again with nice footwork off the sideline to save it. Now Georgia Tech has used all of its timeouts. They have 35 and a half seconds to go. They trail NC State 61-60.
This is a great ball game. You know, down the wire again, Georgia Tech had a great game on Sunday against a Virginia Tech team that's really good, and they're playing a great game against a really good NC State team.
And this is the way it goes between these two teams. It's 4 years in a row that it has been close. Just like this, Parison trying to inbound. Tilford comes to the ball. Starts the offense to the right side for Vucevic. Spencer gets right out in her grill. Back out to Ada Faroka. Now to Vucevic on the left wing. Down low, it's O'Neal. Trying to post up on Nelson. Fakes, puts it up, no good. Gets her own rebound. Surrounded by 3 players. Zaire O'Neal winds up getting fouled.
She has been dominant. You know, when you see 3 players on her, she puts the shot up, shoots it short, but is able to get her own rebound and go back up again. She's been dominant down low for the Jackets and has been playing very strong.
Dominique Wilson wound up committing the foul down inside her 3rd. Zaire O'Neal at the free throw line misses the chance to tie the game. She's got another crack at it, but with 22 2/10 seconds to go, the shot clock turned off. O'Neal's got to step up and make a free throw here to tie this game up. She's looking for a new career high here. She can make this free throw, and she does. 3 games in a row, she has set career highs. Timeout, NC State to advance the ball to the front court with 22.2 seconds to go. A 61-61 tie. It seems like we've been in this situation a lot lately. The Jackets went to overtime at Wake Forest, and they went to overtime in Charlottesville against Virginia. It's a possibility here tonight in Atlanta. We'll see what happens in these final 22 2/10 seconds.
Well, they had the legs for it, and that was big. You know, you missed your first free throw, you get a little down, but Zaire O'Neal was able to step back up and connect on the second one to tie this ball game. And both teams have just been fighting hardcore. You know, I'm sure NC State, they're going to come with a half-court set and a play to get an easy shot or to draw a foul on somebody for the Jackets. So they have to be prepared for this and just play some solid defense.
Remember, Spencer, Wilson, both outstanding free throw shooters. They lost one of their better free throw shooters, Jennifer Mazzarine, who fouled out of the game. Otherwise, you'd be talking about her as a player who you want the ball in the hands of. Here's Spencer going to work to Wilson, way out court. She'll bring it. Again, this is a tie game. Shot clock is turned off. NC State can play for one and a win or overtime. Wilson will pump up a three that is no good with 6 seconds. Nelson could get the rebound. Taken on by O'Neal. O'Neal between defenders, lost it in the backcourt. Picked up by Nelson, who heaves it desperately towards the iron. It is no good. There's the end of regulation. The Tech bench looking out at the floor as if to say, what about the contact?
Yeah, what about
How
the contact?
How was there a no call there as O'Neal tried to break out and tried to get to the front court?
I totally understand it. It's both teams getting at it. That could have been an easy foul call, but that late in the game, I don't believe in referees calling it. Let the players play and see who can finish it out. Now this game is going to overtime.
Well, Georgia Tech is saying, here we go again. Another overtime coming up for the Yellow Jackets. End of regulation. Georgia Tech and NC State are tied at 61. Georgia Tech and NC State are no strangers to overtime. Georgia Tech's in overtime for the third time in the last six games. NC State went to overtime just last Thursday on the road and won at Louisville. Let's see how this one goes over the next 5 minutes.
Yeah, this is going to be interesting. Both teams are well prepared and understand what it takes to win a ball game in overtime. So this is going to be, an aggressive and, you know, energetic overtime to see who wants to pull this win out.
Katarina Vucevic to jump at center against Chelsea Nelson. The tip is ultimately controlled by the Wolfpack. Williams looks around, finds herself open, and a three ball is good, and that's the way overtime begins. Ashley Williams with her fifth three-pointer of the night.
And she can shoot it. That's somebody you can't leave wide open. That's probably the most open or the best look she's had since the first half of this game, and she's able to connect.
64-61 in favor of NC State. Tilford on the drive to the bottom of the foul circle for a nice pull-up jumper that's good. I'm taking for a moment. Ed Sidlaski, I think, may give a warning right here for delay of game. We shall see. It's going to be a review, in fact.
This is interesting.
They will go to the monitor here. Apparently on the Tilford basket. Obviously, it's not going back to the Ashley Williams basket. It's going back to the Ashley Williams basket.
Wow.
She was how many feet beyond the line?
How'd you miss that one?
The expression of some folks on the NC State bench is if at the thought of a replay on that, it was just absurd.
Yeah, she was NBA range on that three. That was good.
64-63. It's been a long night for the officials, I would say. The Wolfpack have the edge here in overtime with 4:23 to go. Williams at that long distance again, so they will shade out in her direction, both Parison and Vucevic near her. To the left side for Spencer, a three-point shooting threat in her own right. Back to Williams, feed it down low to Nelson. Behind the defense for a layup, it's good.
That's too easy right there. It was a great look into Nelson, and she was pretty much wide open. The Jackets were just a little late in recovering on defense to close out.
Under 4 minutes to go in overtime. A steal by Williams. She fronted the bounce pass to the high post and was looking for O'Neal. Georgia Tech with a critical turnover right there, their 15th of the night. Feed it inside to Nelson, trying to add to the three-point lead with a turnaround jumper that's no good. Wilson got in between defenders to knock the rebound out of bounds. It'll be Georgia Tech ball.
Yeah, that was a much-needed stop right there for the Jackets because that was a critical turnover by Tilford, and they were able to recover and get this possession back and try and cut this lead down that NC State has.
A three could tie it. Georgia Tech has made just one three tonight, however. Vucevic feeding it down low to O'Neal. Pass anticipated, stolen away as Wilson came over on help defense and knocked it away. Stolen right back at midcourt from Tilford as she took it away from William. Out to Parison, left corner for three that's no good. O'Neal knocked the rebound away from Nelson. It was at the risk of her fifth foul.
Yeah,
it's
that
almost
was
a
close.
Relief that she only knocked it out of bounds.
That was close. That would have been another over the back for O'Neal, and she could have fouled out of this ball game. But the Jackets, they need to stop trying to force it to O'Neal. try and find something in their offense to see if they can free her up so she could get a better look. Because right now she's being doubled and triple teamed down low.
3:10 to go in overtime. NC State 66, Georgia Tech 63. Wilson driving on Vucevic, draws the contact. Katarina Vucevic picks up her third. And that's Wilson doing what she should do. A great free throw shooter, seeking contact and getting to the line.
She's finding ways to get to that line to help her team, and she's been consistent and really strong for them all night.
She went 4-for-4 during the fourth quarter. 10 of her 19 points came during that huge fourth quarter. Now she's got 20 in this game, and she makes the first. NC State by 4 with 3:08 to go. Wilson goes 2-for-2, just as you would expect. She's 2 off of matching her season high with 21 points now. NC State by 5 in overtime. 3 minutes to go. Tilford sees a chance to drive down low. First shot partially blocked by the double team of Rogers and Williams. NC State making a great play on defense right there.
They have, and they've made a couple of great plays on defense. You know, very heads-up plays by their guards between Williams, Wilson, and also Spencer. They've done a great job in this overtime on defense.
Vucevic breaks up the two-man game. Knocked it free for Ada Faroka. Here's Tilford out to Parazone. Three ball from the left corner is no good. Ada Faroka tried to keep the rebound alive, but Rogers pulls it down for the Wolfpack. Down to 2:27 to go. Georgia Tech's got to come up big on defense again. They trail NC State 68-63. NC State will go to work and run some clock in the half court way out on the perimeter. They've got it in Spencer's hands at long range. Tilford watching her loosely, of course, as Tilford plays with 4 fouls. Spencer on a drive. Out to the wing for Rogers. Shot clock down to 3. Rogers got to force one up wildly. That's no good. Rebound to Ada Faroka. NC State may have taken too much time in the half court. Lead pass to O'Neal. Behind the field for a layup. It's good. NC State did not get back on defense.
And that was a great look right there, because O'Neal was wide open. I don't know what NC State was doing, but that's the easiest look O'Neal's gotten all night.
28 points for Zaire O'Neal. Again, adding to her career high. Bounce pass through the double team. Finds Nelson inside for the layup, and she got fouled. They set up a two-man game again and ran it nicely that time. And Nelson will go to the line trying to complete a three-point play.
And that's the fifth right there on O'Neal. And that's a tough blow for the Jackets, because they needed her in this ball game if they were going to continue to try and win in this overtime. And that was just another heads-up play by NC State trying to isolate Nelson against O'Neal. And Nelson's able to draw the foul in and finish the play.
O'Neal fouls out for the fifth time this year. It completes a night in which she set a new career high for the third straight game, going for 28 points and adding 9 rebounds at the free throw line. Chelsea Nelson connects. She has 15 points. You have 4 Wolfpack players with 15 points or more, and NC State leads at 71-65 with 90 seconds to go. And now Tech's got to run the offense in the half court without Zaire O'Neal. Tilford takes it upon herself, driving inside, and she gets blocked down in deep by Ashley Williams, who picks up her fourth. And it stops the clock with 1:24 to go.
It does. These are going to be some key free throws right here for Tilford, because with O'Neal out, the Jackets are going to have to find a way to score buckets and score them quick. They're down 5, but if she can cut this lead to 3, you know, maybe they'll have a shot still in this overtime.
Free throw good for Tilford, who is 5-for-5 tonight shooting free throws. She's made 11 in a row now over the last couple of games. She's enjoying her fourth straight double-figure scoring game. That little shoulder shimmy. And the second free throw is up and good.
She's automatic now in that free throw line. What a couple of games will do, you know, can change her whole perspective. She's been doing great.
71-67. Georgia Tech has to come up on defense big again. 1:16 to go in the game. Williams to the right corner for Rogers. Out to the left side for Spencer, leaving her feet and settling it. Kaylin Pugh creeping out to watch her on defense. They bounce it into the lane. Going up in deep, it was Wilson, and she got fouled.
And that was a late call. I mean, seemed like they were just letting them play, and they were going to let it happen, going to the basket. Wilson trying to draw the foul, but that's a late call.
And it's on Imani Tilford, no less. She fouls out for the first time this year.
That's tough. You have 2 starters that are critical to the Jackets fouling out, especially in this point in the game. And Michelle Joseph's going to have to go down her bench and see what she can make happen.
Two starters who have combined for 40 points tonight. Now fouling out in overtime. And Dominique Wilson going to the free throw line yet again. 6 for 6 here on the evening. Free throw's good.
She's automatic. That's the person you do not want at the free throw line. But, you know, NC State, they're a great free throw shooting team. And Wilson has just been pretty heads up and trying to get to the basket and been able to draw a lot of fouls tonight.
1:03 to go. Wilson goes 2 for 2 in this overtime. 73-67. Harris on forecourt after with Vucevic, Ada Faroka, Pugh, and Scott. Tilford and O'Neal on the bench having fouled out. Pugh drives down inside and gets fouled to stop the clock with 52:09 seconds to go.
And that was a good drive by Pugh. She was right at that free throw line and turned around and faced the basket and saw no one was really on her and just drove it and was able to get to the line.
Foul on Kayla Ely is her first. Kaylin Pugh with her first free throw. It is no good.
These are critical. You got to hit these free throws in the overtime if you're going to cut down this lead. You got 52.9 seconds left in this ball game, and every basket is needed, and it's going to count.
Pugh with her second rolled off, no good. Rebound to Spencer in the backcourt. They don't particularly want to foul her, but they might need to think about doing so. Georgia Tech trails 73-67 with 43 seconds to go. Spencer. Running the clock way out court. Shot clock's down to 12, and Spencer's in no hurry. Rogers offers her a screen out high. Spencer's still working it. Out to Williams, left corner for three. It's no good. Rebound to Parisone. She'll work it quickly into the forecourt. Parisone pulls up and tries a two from the foul line. That's no good. Williams with the rebound with 19 seconds to go. She'll be fouled in her backcourt. That's all Antonio Parisone could do to stop the clock. In a desperate attempt to try and keep the Yellow Jackets in this game, but NC State's got a 6-point lead, and they got Ashley Williams going to the free throw line.
Yeah, and at this point, it's looking like NC State's going to be able to close this ball game out. They have Ashley Williams, who's a good free throw shooting guard as well for NC State, going to the line. So considering if she hits these two, it's going to extend NC State's lead to 8.
Williams on the stat sheet, a 60% free throw shooter, but let's go into our Georgia Tech math, our classes we took, and say small sample size. We know what kind of a shooter she is, but misses that free throw.
Yeah, she does miss that free throw, and probably she doesn't go to the free throw line that often. She's an outside shooter, so she's looking to score the basketball from the three-point line.
17.9 seconds remaining in overtime. Williams made the second of two. Timeout Georgia Tech. They got another timeout when overtime began, and now they use it here to advance the ball to the 28-foot line. So a timeout here in the extra period with 17.9 seconds to go. NC State 74, Georgia Tech 67.
And this is a possible unfortunate loss for the Jackets. They played extremely hard to get this game into overtime. It's been several lead changes, and NC State looked like at points they were going to have it in regulation, but Jackets were able to soar back and tie the ball game and send it OT, and foul trouble is what played the Jackets all evening long.
With our game going into overtime, all the other games in the ACC have had a chance to finish. Clemson did beat Pitt at Pittsburgh. Florida State rolled past Wake Forest 102-60 in Tallahassee. Final from Coral Gables, Miami winning at home, beating Virginia 63-52. And in Blacksburg, Louisville puts 30 points on the board in the fourth quarter and wind up winning 88-70 over Virginia Tech. Florida State now, the sole team atop the ACC with their 11-1 record, a half game in front of Notre Dame. Georgia Tech will face Notre Dame on Sunday in another Play for K game in South Bend. Duke and Syracuse idle tonight. They're going to play tomorrow night in a game between the two teams tied for third place in the league. If NC State holds its lead in the final 17.9 seconds, they're going to stay tied for fifth with Louisville. Although NC State enjoys a tiebreaker with the Cardinals by virtue of that overtime win last week at the KFC Yum Center. Miami now 7-5, Wake Forest 5-6. Virginia going to 4-7. Virginia Tech drops to 3-8. They're tied with Pitt immediately behind Georgia Tech. You may have a three-way tie for 10th remaining among Georgia Tech, Virginia Tech, and Pittsburgh, unless the Jackets can come up with a miracle here in the final 17.9 seconds of the overtime.
Yeah, you never want to count a team out, so you don't know what could happen if they could hit some quick threes. But, you know, NC State's just been pretty consistent at playing some solid defense in this overtime and going to the free throw line when they get fouled and knocking down free throws.
We saw Tech head coach Michelle Joseph moments ago. We had her team involved in its third overtime game in its last six outings. Georgia Tech will inbound from the right hash mark. Shea Sweeney in the game to put it in play, joined by Scott, Vucevic, Parison, and Pond. There are three-point shooting options out there. Sweeney inbounds to Pond. She forced up a three that's blocked by Dede Rogers. NC State will try and run out the clock. Vucevic will have none of that. She'll foul Maya Spencer in the backcourt with 11.5 seconds remaining in the game. But this one seemingly belongs to NC State at 74-67 as Maya Spencer will walk to the free throw line.
Yeah, it's just been a tough night. The fouls in the first half and continuing in the second half, it just caused the Jackets, who were resilient and still fought hard in this game, even though they were in foul trouble. But NC State, with their senior leadership and their guard play and their whole starting lineup with four seniors and one junior, they're a good team, and they're going to do extremely well as the ACC continues and probably have a good showing in the NCAA tournament.
After making the first, Spencer missed the second. Sweeney races Forkel with 5 seconds. Vucevic will try a three. Rebound in the lane to Parison as it taken away again by Dede Rogers. And there's your ball game as NC State, for the second straight game, wins in overtime on the road. That's the kind of team NC State has been this year. One of the toughest customers to deal with in the ACC. They trailed by 10 at one time in this game, wind up winning by 8 in overtime, no less.
And they stay settled, you know, with their senior leadership, especially at the guard play. They never get too high, never get too low, and they just take and play the game in spurts. They knew they were down 10. They fought back, regained the lead. The Jackets came back, tied it up, and then they just took control in the overtime, and they were able to come out with the victory.
Zaire O'Neal in the losing effort scored 28 points, a career high for the Yellow Jackets, who go to 14-10 on the year, 3-8 in the ACC. NC State, meanwhile, has now won 5 of their last 6 games. They're 18-6 on the year and 8-3 in the Atlantic Coast Conference. They got 23 points tonight from Dominique Wilson. For our radio audience, stay tuned. The postgame show is coming up. Premier courtside for Fallon Stokes. I'm Richard Musker, saying so long from McCamish Pavilion here in Atlanta, where the final score tonight in overtime was NC State 75 and Georgia Tech 67. To watch this entire game on replay, as well as other games on our family of ESPN Networks, log on to watchespn.com or download the Watch ESPN app. This ACC Network Extra presentation comes to you from ESPN.